Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so it has been a great conference. I will say something at the end, but for the moment, let's do some mathematics. So I will talk about a result which is not quite new. The first version is about 2 years old. And let me just give the broad statement before explaining what I will do with that. So the first part of the talk will be about explaining what it means. So the words in red, there are several things in red in this statement, will be explained. So in order to at least to have a precise mathematical statement. But actually then, after giving a short idea of the proof, very short actually, what I would like is really to discuss what comes beyond that, which are not theorems, which are open questions, some work in progress. And so the last part of the talk will be really on, say, comments and questions regarding this theorem. Okay, so I will not read what you can see, but so this talks about several objects that I will now define. So standard interval exchange map will be the simplest object. And then you will have this simple deformation. And then I will also have to explain what means almost all at the beginning and what are these two integers, G and S, which appear in the formula for the codimension. I assume that the words in black are understandable right now. Okay, so let's start with the interval exchange map, standard interval exchange map. So first, rotations, circle rotations. If I cut the circle at the origin, I get the interval 0, 1, and then the rotation by alpha becomes the exchange, as it is indicated on the left, the exchange of two intervals. And I've just drawn here the graph. The graph is made of the two segments which are parallel to the diagonal. Now, a standard interval exchange map is nothing else than doing the same thing, but with more intervals, more sub-intervals. So here is an example with four sub-intervals, which are actually just permuted in the opposite way. I mean, and so you have the graph, which is this time now the union of four segments, which are parallel to the diagonal. So you see that to define a standard interval exchange map, you need two things. A combinatorial data which comes on the next slide to explain how the intervals are permuted. And then you need to know, obviously, also the length of the subinterval to define completely the transformation. So regarding combinatorial data, it's useful to give names to the subinterval, to use some finite alphabet. So typically, I will call D the number of subintervals. A will be the alphabet with D letters to name the subinterval. And so, for instance, for rotation, we have just two intervals, which I call AB, just because I first two letters of the alphabet. This will be the combinatorial data in the case of a rotation. In the other example that I gave with four subintervals, so you remember, if you come back to the, A was here and goes here, B was here and goes here, etc. And so you have ABCD on the top line before the transformation and DCB on the bottom line after the transformation. So these are the combinatorial data. So now, this explains what is the standard interval exchange map. There is just a restriction on the combinatorial data, but a kind of trivial one. You are asked that the same subset of the alphabet does not appear at the beginning of both the bottom and top line in order not to have a trivial thing. Just if you had something like A, B, C, D, something like that, and on the bottom line, you just make B, A, and perhaps D, C. Obviously, I can cut the interval in two invariant pieces, and instead of having one interval exchange map, I have actually two separate disjoint interval exchange maps. So assuming that the combinatorial data are never of this kind, which is a kind of irreducibility. Okay, so this is for the, I would say, rigid objects, the transformation that generalized circle, rigid rotation on the circle. Now about the nonlinear objects, here is a generalized interval exchange map. You see that now I still cut the interval where the transformation acts in two ways, the top way here and the bottom way here, but now the subintervals have not necessarily the same length because the map, the restriction of the map to each subinterval is no more a translation. It can be any orientation preserving homeomorphism or diffeomorphism. Just in the case of diffeomorphism, I will ask that the transformation is a diffeomorphism including, including the endpoint. I don't allow for the derivative to explode at the end. Okay, so this is a generalized interval exchange map, but still, if I come back to the case of two intervals, you see that it's not exactly, it is definitely this, which is the case of two intervals, is definitely an homeomorphism of the circle. But if I'm going to higher differentiability, you see that there is the issue of the continuity of the derivatives or the any order at this breakpoint here or here. And so if I want really a circle diffeomorphism, I should ask that the jet of the transformation here is the same and here, and similarly that the jet is here is the same at here. So it's not completely obvious. I will talk about that later, but it's not completely obvious what one should do in the case of more intervals, because I mean, you didn't break the circle, so no circle to reconstruct. Actually, a way around this problem at the moment is just to consider a special class of generalized interval exchange maps, the one that I call simple deformation. So here is the definition. I will say that generalized interval exchange map T is a simple deformation of a standard one T0. So recall that T0 is the one with the which is a translation of each subinterval. If first the two subdivisions are the same for T and T0, and T should be of class CR if I'm calling a CR deformation, but the important property is the last one, T should coincide with T0 in the neighborhood of the singularities. So here is the drawing. In black, you have the standard interval exchange map. In red, you have the simple deformation, and at the endpoint here, it coincides with T0. You just perturb in this compact, inside, away from the singularities. So in this case, because I did not touch the singularities, I don't have to think about this question of making the jets coincide that I had if I wanted the circle diffeomorphism. So this is now, so simple deformation was one of the terms in the theorem. So I can come back to the theorem, and I see that now I've still in red the almost all which is here, but which will be explained in this slide, and these two integers, G and S, which are here. Okay, almost all is very clear, because you see that the parameter space for standard interval exchange map is nothing else than the simplex of dimension one. Once I fix the combinatorial data, and obviously there are only finite number of possible combinatorial data, what I have to do is to choose the length of the subintervals, but obviously up to a scaling, because the length I could normalize, for instance, the total length of the interval to be one. And then so I have exactly d minus one lengths, which have to add to one, but d lengths, sorry, which have to add to one. So I have a simplex of dimension d minus one. So I'm considering Lebesgue measure on this simplex, and this almost all is actually with relation to this Lebesgue measure. But actually, if you read the paper, or if you go more deeply in the proof, this almost all is, I would say, quite explicit, not it corresponds to some Diophantine condition, actually. So Diophantine condition on T0, which is explicit, which can be proved to be a full measure, and which we call restricted Roth type. I will not define this condition at the moment. Actually, I will not define completely the condition in the talk. You have to go to the paper. I will say something about the condition at the end of the talk. So we have this Diophantine condition of full measure, which explains this almost all. Actually, it's the precise statement is for all t0 which are of this restricted Roth type, then the conclusion here is true. Okay, I have still to explain what are these integers g and s. So g is, as you could expect, is a genus from the notation. The genus of what? Of the surface that you get by suspending an interval exchange map. So if you start with a circle rotation, you have an easy way to construct a torus. So I have my rotation, which is exchanging the interval A. So A is going here, B is going here. So there are the two intervals which are exchanged. Then I have just to choose some vertical parameter to have a first vector VA with the horizontal component given by the length of the interval, and the vertical component is arbitrary. I choose such a vertical component. The same for the second vector VB. I've made the drawing in order that this is horizontal, but this is not absolutely necessary for the construction. It's just made for simpler drawings. And then I will, from this parallelogram, identify the opposite side and get the torus. And you see that on this torus, which is a special case of a general geometric object called the translation surface, I will have a vertical vector field if I go up. So I get here, then I get the identification here, and I go back here. And the return map on this horizontal segment is nothing else than the rotation I started with. So suspending, again, suspending the rotation, I get a torus where the vertical vector field has, as the first return map on the horizontal segment, exactly this rotation. Okay, so this, what I just did for rotation and getting a torus, a surface of genus 1, I can do for more complicated standard interval exchange map. So here I started with, again, the same combinatorics, A, B, C, D on the top, D, C, B, A on the bottom. I have to choose vertical coordinates for the vector associated to A, B, C, D, in order that these three points are above this horizontal line and these three points are below. This is always possible. And then I get a surface, I get first an octagon. I get an octagon with a pair of parallel sides with the same name. A here, B here, C here, D here. So what I do is that I identify the pair of parallel sides to get a surface. And then, there is a singularity which corresponds to the vertices of the octagon. In this particular combinatorics, you can check that actually all vertices will be identified. If you start here, the number one here, this is identified here with the second one, two, and then the B side is identified to the B side, so you go on with the three, then with the four, with the five here, the six, seven, eight, and you are back to the initial point. So we have only one singularity, one marked point on this surface. And so, in this case, on the next picture, if you compute the total angle around, you can see that the total angle is 6 pi around this singularity. And so by Gauss-Bonnet, you have some flat metric with a single singularity, conical singularity of angle 6 pi means that the surface of genus 2. Alors, in general, what I just did for this particular combinatorics, this just depends obviously on the combinatorics. It doesn't depend on the length of the interval. It just depends on the fact that I had A, B, C, D, D, C, B, A. And so this I can do in general. There are formula, there is a very easy process to compute the genus of the surface, the number of conical singularities. Actually, I will do that in a moment, and then the angles at these singularities, the kappa I here are integers, and bon, in the particular case we have just seen for the special combinatorics, we had one conical singularity, and kappa 1 was equal to 3, and so you have the usual relation, say, this is Gauss-Bonnet, minus the Euler characteristic is the sum of the excess angle that you have. Here, a relation between the number of intervals, the genus, and the number of singularities. So we had, again, d equals to 4, g equals to 2, s equals to 1, which is OK. And here, kappa 1 equals to 3, sorry, and g equals to 2. OK, so this is part general. So now you have all the elements to understand the theorems that I stated at the beginning. Yeah, the G and S are given by just the combinatorial data of the standard interval exchange map. Actually, there is a version of the theorem which is here for flows, say for flows. I mean, perturbing the vertical flow. We have seen that if I start with a standard interval exchange map, and I can see it as a return map of the vertical vector field on, so I should say, yeah, sorry, I did not say, but in this construction, again, if I'm looking at the vertical vector field, starting here, I go here, it is identified here, I come back here, and the return map, again, is exactly the standard interval exchange map I started with. So it's really a suspension. So at the level of the vector field on surface, on translation surface, it's like that. Alors, it's for almost any translation surface. Again, there is the notion of translation surface of restricted Roth type, condition actually on the vertical vector field on the translation surface, the Diophantine condition. So if you start with this data, alors, you have to look at the parameter space, which we have added more parameters because of the vertical parameters, but actually these parameters do not play any role in the Diophantine condition. So what you get is, again, some CR equivalence class. This is not surprising because we will actually, to prove this theorem, apply the first theorem applied to the return map and then lift the conjugacy in order to get a CR diffeomorphism of the manifold close to its identity on the surface. But obviously, when I lift in this way, I will not respect time. I mean, the return time do not need to coincide. So what I get is only a CR equivalence class, meaning that I respect the sense of time, but I will not respect time. I just will respect the orbits. But the codimension here is the same. So simple deformation is just the same, same thing that it was before. It just means that I'm not touching anything close to the singularities. I'm just considering deformation away from the singular point of the translation surface. OK. I promised before to explain something about this jet condition at the end point of the interval. So simple deformation was just a way around this difficulty, but let me just explain this difficulty. It's actually quite simple. So assume that you start with combinatorial data pi. Unfortunately, there is some notation. So pi t, and pi b are two applications from the alphabet to the set of numbers between 1 and d, which just indicate in which order you mean, for instance, if the combinatorial data was this one, you just send a to 1, b to 2, c to 3, and d to 4. This is for pi t. T is for top, and b for bottom. This one, this is pi b. So you define these four letters, which are just the first and last letter in the top and bottom lines. So they're just a notation. And then you define this on the, so this is the product of I have just the set of letters with a symbol which is left or right, L or R. L for left, R for right, you will see that it will come in as the endpoints of the subinterval. The subintervals are labeled by the alphabet, and each subinterval has a left and a right endpoint. So this is the set of endpoints for the subintervals. And So I have a permutation, natural permutation, which is given by this formula. But this formula, nothing else that if you remember the drawing that I had in the suspension, I had A, B, C, D, A. This was the drawing that I had before. And so it's just making the picture that when you go around, when you go around like that, say, huh, this would be the right endpoint of the segment A. The next one will be the left endpoint of the segment B. So this is, which is also here. And then the next one will be the right extremity of the segment R, et cetera. So you will see you will alternate between left and right, except at this level, which corresponds to the last and first letter that I just mentioned, where you have two consecutive left endpoints here and two consecutive right endpoints here. So this is just what this formula means. You just go around, and this permutation sigma is exactly taking care of that. And so from what I just said, the cycles of sigma are exactly this marked point on the surface. Now, why I'm doing that is because I will associate to every element here, such of this type, a jet of, say, if I'm considering CR, generalized interval exchange map, T of class CR, I will consider the R jet at this endpoint. I will shift to the origin. So I want to consider the jet as a group. So I'm shifting everything to the origin, but then I'm considering this jet here. I do the same at the right endpoint, obviously. And now I make this complicated product. So these exponents are plus or minus one, depending whether you are a left or right. But I have to do that in a right order. The jet group is not commutative. So I'm making this product. It's an element in the jet groups of order R. And so it's more complicated. It's more easy than it looks, because this proposition is quite trivial. It's quite trivial. It says first that if I start with two generalized interval exchange map, which are conjugated by some CR diffeomorphism, then the things that I get here are conjugated in the jet, group jet. But conversely, I've written the converse only in the case that I'm interested in. If you start with something such that these are trivial, the identity elements in the group jet, then actually you can make a conjugacy in order to get a simple deformation. So simple deformation is up to conjugacy, and the same thing that to us that this invariant are trivial. Anyway, if I want to conjugate something to the standard interval exchange map, I need this conjugacy invariant to be trivial, because it is a conjugacy invariant and it is trivial for the standard interval exchange map. So this explains now what you should do in general if you want to consider generalized interval exchange map, which are not necessarily simple deformation. You just assume that these invariants are trivial, which are algebraic conditions on the jet, and they are necessary conditions. Okay, so let me give, before coming to the comments, on the theorem, let me give a very brief sketch of proof. Alors, the proof is actually an adaptation of a proof by Michel Herrmann for the case of circle diffeomorphism, which was published actually in the bulletin of the Sociedad Brasileira de Matemática 85. And it's based on the Schwarzian derivative. So it's a proof at the moment when R is at least three, in the theorem R was at least two. So I'm leaving the case R equal two on the side at the moment. So for R at least three, you introduce the Schwarzian derivative, that's this formula. You have this usual composition law for the Schwarzian derivative. And then if you have, so I'm looking for the conjugacy equation, T0 is my standard interval exchange map. T is the one, the simple deformation that I try to conjugate to T0. I'm writing the conjugacy equation. And by taking Schwarzian derivative here, what I get is this equation. From this formula, I get this equation. So you recognize here the cohomology equation for T0. But obviously, as always, I mean, in this stuff, the problem is that H appears in here, but also here. So you have to do something in order to solve this equation. And even solving this equation is not the end, because here you took three derivatives from here to here, and you have a non-trivial issue of integrating. Remember that you have a lot of discontinuities. So it's not just one single constant of integration. There are more than that. There are actually d constant of integration for each derivative that you take. Okay, so starting from here, so calling the endpoints of I by U0 and UD. So first you consider what was this term here. This term here, given H of class CR, a diffeo of class CR. You consider this. This is of class CR minus 1 because of the DH. T was of class CR plus 3. So ST was of class CR. This, so the here it's which makes it of class CR minus 1. But the 0 means, because I've considered simple deformation, I've no problem of discontinuity, because this is actually 0 near the endpoint. Okay, so I have this, and it is a function of TH, which is a nice function of T and H in functional space. Now, this is here that there is a lot of work, but the work was done earlier, first by Forni, and then this more precise result with Marmi and Moussa. So this is the linear equation. So in order to solve the linear equation with second term, so the second term was here, I certainly need to put a mean value 0, so I'm subtracting the mean value, but still, in general, I have to correct this term in order to be able to solve for some CR minus 3 function. I have to correct with a chi which lies in a finite dimensional space with this dimension. This is, there is a lot of, you have to work to prove that, but this is done independently, it's a linear equation. And so the dimension is this one. As you see, for genus 1, this doesn't exist, the dimension is 0. But in higher genus, you will really need to introduce this term here in order to be able to solve. So. So you write, say, still you still write this in this way. The psi is normalized by this condition. This is just a condition to normalize psi, because obviously if psi is a solution, psi plus constant is also a solution. Now, once you have psi, remember from the previous equation, psi is supposed to be the Schwarzschild derivative of H. So what you do is, so only that psi is defined up to a constant. So you solve this equation. Actually, to go from psi to H, solving this by integration, you need two constants, one because psi was defined up to a constant here, and the second one because you have three primitives to take, but because H is supposed to be a diffeomorphism from the interval onto itself, there are only already two constraints. So the three parameters are really C0 and C1, which are here. So now if you take T equals to T0, so in this case, obviously this is a zero function, so psi is equal to 0, etc. And so you can see that when T is equal to T0, the map here is a constant map. It does not depend at all on the H, because the T is killing the H. So it's a constant map when T equals to T0. It means that when T is close to T0, which we are assuming, this will be actually contraction. And so it will have a unique fixed point. And so we denote this unique fixed point like that. You have still two free constants here. It's a, by implicit function theorem, it's a C1 function of T, C0, and C1. Alors, as I explained at the beginning, you have now solved the equation, must solve modulo this term, which is here, which is not good. And also, you have still to integrate. So the last part of the proof, so denoting by the discontinuity, the point which separates the interval by UI, you prove, so No, this part is not difficult. That the fixed point that you got is the conjugacy you were looking at, if and only if the following conditions are satisfied. First, chi has to be equal to zero. This is the first condition, obviously, I mean, because I really wanted to solve the equation, not the equation mode something. Then you need H to be continuous, which was not automatic, to fix the discontinuities, which certainly not automatic. You need also to have continuity of the first and second derivative. You don't have to be to worry about higher derivative, because after, for the derivative of order 3 and more, you have the equation with the Schwarzian derivative. And so if the first derivatives are OK, the following will be automatically OK from the linear equation. But these ones are not automatic at all. Actually, so there is a relation between I and G that I will not explain, which is not very interesting here. But the point is that you have this set of equations, you have this fixed point here, and when you look at this set of equations, you use the implicit function theorem. This is not exactly the number of equations, and these equations are not independent, but still you can deal with this equation in order to count the number of independent equations and to see that the number of independent equations, which are necessary, gives exactly the C1 manifold that you look for, which has, so there is a parenthesis missing here, but it's G minus 1 to R plus 1 plus S, which was the co-dimension that I was talking at the beginning. Okay, so now the rest of the talk is about comments on the theorem, things which are not done, and questions. So first, the case R equals 2. This is easy. This requires some substantial modification, but the general idea is the same. You don't have the Schwarzian to play with, but what you get is that you have still the primitive of the Schwarzian. And the primitive of the Schwarzian, H being of class C2 now, is this function. And you can adapt the proof. You have to work somewhat, but you can adapt the proof in order to just use this function instead of the Schwarzian derivative and still make the proof work in the same way. The case R equals 1 is, I will discuss in a few slides, the theorem should be true. We have seen this formula for the codimension. It was S plus G minus 1 times 2R plus 1. And so you see that in case of genus 1, the codimension is S. In the simplest case, which is D equals to 2, two intervals, S is equal to 1. And so you have the codimension 1 that you expect, because you need, obviously, that T to have the same rotation number as T0. You started with a T0, which has good Diophantine properties. In order for a T close to T0 to be conjugated to T0, you need T to have the same rotation number. And this is also sufficient if T0 is Diophantine. So in this case, you have the same codimension independent of the regularity that you require. But as you have seen, in genus bigger than 1, it's very, very different. The codimension of the CR conjugacy class of T0, of the Diophantine interval exchange map, will augment, increase linearly with the regularity. For instance, in this special case of this combinatorics, the codimension is 2R plus 2 for any R at least 2. So it starts with 6 for R equals to 2. Okay, this is a local theorem. This is a local theorem. In the conclusion of the theorem, we were asking that the conjugacy was a diffeomorphism which was CR close to the identity. So we only look at T, which is close to T0, and only look for a conjugacy which is close to the identity. It's a perturbative stating. I don't know. I mean, there is an obvious question about the global stating, is the following. If you look at the diffeomorphism and conjugate T0 by this diffeomorphism, you get some generalized interval exchange map. And an obvious question is whether this map is proper, whether, so you start with a nice submanifold locally. I don't know if this manifold, if you start extending it in a natural way, enfin, by taking H to be large further from the identity, it could come back. Hein? It could accumulate in a non-trivial place. I don't know. This is completely open and certainly deserves investigation. I have no idea of the answer, actually. Another comment is about the case r equal to 1. I definitely expect that the case r equal to 1 works in the same way, so the codimension would be in this case, so the codimension will be written. It's actually, we have not only an ID, but we are trying to work write a proof, but the proof, the details are not written yet, so I will certainly not claim at this level that it is a theorem, but certainly, I mean, it's more than a conjecture. If you look at what means the theorem for equals to 1, the codimension should be equal to 3g minus 3 plus s. This is the formula that we had before. So it is d minus 1. Recall that d is 2g plus s minus 1 plus d minus 1. So why do I write this in this way? It's because d minus 1, the first term here, is the dimension of parameter space for standard interval exchange map. So if you want, it's the dimension of the rotation number, the space for rotation number. I will come back to this, but so this would be the expected codimension of the C1 conjugacy class. For instance, in this particular case, again, the C1 conjugacy class should be, for at least for Diophant, again, not for all T0. T0 is always here, assumed to be Diophantine, enfin, restricted rod type, to be precise. So it's true for almost all T0, but not for all T0. And should be 4, to compare with 3, which is D minus 1. Finally, still going down for R, if you consider the topological conjugacy, I suspect this. Alors, this is a conjecture in the sense that I think that there is a good chance to be true, but I have no idea for proof. Is that we have a rigidity. So as soon as T, which is a simple deformation again, so C4 is just to be safe. It could work with perhaps less than C4, but the C4 is not really important. If T is C0 conjugated to T0, I expect actually to be C1. So it's a rigidity result. So it would mean that, again, the zero conjugacy class would have the same dimension, the same codimension than the C1 conjugacy class. Be careful that in higher genus, in genus 2 or more, conjugacy is not the same thing as having the same rotation number. There is no Donjoua-like theorem. Actually, it's a big problem that, I don't know, to describe the set of smooth generalized interval exchange map, or simple deformation, if you want, which have given the same rotation number as T0. Alors, what means the same rotation number? I don't want to go too much into that. I will not go. For those who know, it means that you have the same Rozhevich renormalization sequence than T0. Let me just say that for D equals to 2, the Rozhevich renormalization sequence is nothing else than the continued fraction sequence. So you would say I have the same, the way that the orbits are ordered on the interval is giving you the continued fraction of the rotation number. And if you have the same continued, si two numbers have the same continued fraction, they are equal. So here it's just an extended definition of the rotation number. So by this definition, but actually it is equivalent to have a monotone semi-conjugacy between T and T0. So you have this Poincaré result on the circle, that any homeomorphism with irrational rotation number will be semi-conjugated with the rotation with the same rotation number, and the same is true here. So really, if you want to take as a definition of rotation number the fact that you have the monotone semi-conjugacy to T0, it is OK. So the problem is to describe this semi-conjugacy class. And unfortunately, unlike the case of the circle, where you have this family, you can compose by a rotation, and there is a unique value of the rotation for which you get a given irrational rotation number. Here, we don't have anything at the moment the same. For in particular, we don't know whether this is true. We expect this to be true, it's perhaps optimistic, but at least this is the first statement that you would like to confirm or disprove, but whatever is true, because this is, the dimension of the set of standard interval exchange map, and you could expect to push, in a sense, a map in different directions in order to realize any rotation number. But this is really an open problem that I don't know. Again, so what I just said before, there is no Danjoua-like theorem. If you take even something which is very as regular as you wish, which is a piecewise affine interval exchange map, so something which certainly satisfies Danjoua's theorem on the circle, then actually most of them will have wandering intervals as soon as the genus is bigger than one. So there is a sequence of examples. These are really examples, and the last result by Marmi and Moussa and myself is really saying that for almost all T0 and the most also from T here. So I mean, the general case, so it explains why you expect here to be something of dimension D minus one, but the C0 conjugacy class to be of codimension D minus one plus G minus one. You expect that the C0 conjugacy class in the semi-conjugacy class should be of codimension G minus one. But this is conjecture again. This is definitely not proven. So the last command, the last one, so it's about this Diophantine condition. I don't want to define the Diophantine condition. There are four conditions, A, B, C, D. And the last three are actually related to something that we will not introduce, but which is very central in all this stuff, which is the so-called Concevitz-Zoritch co-cycle. A lot of work has been done on that. So there are, I would say, conditions of spectral type. I'm interested in the last condition because this is the only one which you have to check in genus one. In genus one, because the other one are automatic. They are not automatic at all in higher genus, but in genus one, they are automatic. So what is this condition A? When if you just specialize this condition for D equals to 2, this is the usual Roth condition that you can, the bad approximation with an exponent tau, which is as close as zero as you want, the celebrated Roth condition because it is satisfied by algebraic irrational numbers. In general, it's very similar to that. So this is the general case where, again, the singularities of T, these are the singularities of T minus one, the point which separates the subinterval on the bottom line. And then you have these two conditions. First, you don't want a singularity to go too close to another singularity. I will iterate backward V because it's a singularity for T minus one, so I iterate forward, sorry. And then I don't want to run too close to a singularity of T. Actually, to be irrational means that these quantities are never zero. When you try to define what means for a standard interval exchange map to be irrational, this is precisely to ask that these quantities are non-zero. And here you ask that they are not too small. But there is a second condition, which is here that the orbits are rather dense, in a sense that if you look at the orbit up to time n, then it will approximate any point within n to the power minus one. Enfin, minus one would be the most optimistic, but actually minus one plus tau. So you have some margin, but tau again is arbitrarily small. It's for all positive tau, there exists this constant C. So this is the one part of the restricted Roth type that I was taking. The other are really spectral conditions which don't talk about the orbits at all. They talk about some matrices which you can define from the renormalization Rosiewicz sequence. So just a question to conclude, the mathematical part. Well, you would like to determine the set of standard interval exchange map for which the conclusion holds, say the CR conjugacy class has finite podimension. The reason is that for two intervals, you know the answer. It's the usual Diophantine condition, meaning that you now have any tau is allowed instead of asking for the condition for all positive tau and intersection of all tau. It's here the union of all tau. I don't have any good candidate in general, even for the linearized equation. And so this is a question about the conjugacy equation, but even if you look at the level of the linear equation, if you look which are the rotation number for which you can solve the equation within a thing of finite dimension, the answer is not known. Okay, so this is, I think, the end. Thank you first for your attention. Wait a minute. So also,